You're rolling?
We are rolling.
Okay, I am rolling there.
It's all yours.
It's all mine. And we're back. Look at this.
It's your show.
It's my show now. It's my.
It is only your show.
It is my show, and I have a co-host. I'm Marty Soloway, KC1CWF. Welcome back to the Phasing Line.
Pay no attention to the guy sitting
and,
on this side of the camera.
What's your show called?
It's the Ham Nation.
Ham Nation.
Ham Nation Now.
Ham Nation Now.
Ham Radio Now.
This is Ham Radio Now. And
No, it's just your show.
And Phasing Line Podcast. I'm Marty KC1CWF.
Can I stick it on my show?
Yeah, you can stick it on your show.
Okay.
This, I'm Marty KC1CWF, your...
Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, but you told me that I needed to make... not interrupt you too much.
No, that's no. I never said that.
Oh, okay.
You can check him out, hamradionow.tv, phasinglinepodcast.com. Give us both money. It's both on both of our websites.
Yeah.
But we're talking about something that happened a while ago. What? It's May. It's May. So I'm with KB3VVE. That's a tongue twister. Emily. And we're talking NPOTA.
NPOTA.
NPOTA. And not POTA, no POTA, no more POTA. It's National Parks on the Air. So, you were, how would you describe yourself? You were a POTA addict?
That would probably be accurate to say.
Yeah. So what was National Parks? I guess it was an on-the-air event, right? So
it was a year-long on-the-air event to celebrate the centennial for the National Park Service.
So parks were considered like rare entities, and people tried to work them, basically, right?
Yes, you tried to work as many as you could.
So people got pretty into that and passionate about it. How many parks did you activate over the course of the year?
I activated 53 parks.
53 parks. So let's talk a little bit about...
What part of the country?
Yeah.
I live in Pennsylvania, eastern Pennsylvania, about 20 miles from Harrisburg.
Did you get them as close to home as possible or travel around a lot?
The closest park was the Appalachian Trail, and that was about 7 or 8 miles from where I live. So I've frequented that pretty often.
And how far away did you go?
The furthest I went was New York City, and that was for the Statue of Liberty.
Let's talk about that. How was getting permission to activate the Statue of Liberty? Any red
tape?
That
was a lot of red tape. I started it around the same time that Peter Kobach, K-O-B-A-K, started his, or he had started his earlier. We were both unaware of the fact that we were starting the process, and he was granted the permit, and I had been turned down because the dates that I had asked for, there was a big event going on at the Statue of Liberty. So he went actually the day after my permit had been turned down, and he had talked to the girl in charge of permits, and we had found out then that I had been turned down because of the fact the date I requested was a bad date. So I reapplied, and then I was granted a day. It was a Wednesday, and it was a lot of red tape. It was a lot of emails, a lot of phone calls, and trying to explain to them what we were and why we were going to be there and that we weren't actually dangerous.
So where did you set up camp, per se?
We were on the kind of the side to the back of the Statue of Liberty. The statue was about to my left side, if I remember correctly. If I just turned to the left, I could see it.
But you did put your antennas up on the torch.
No, that was discouraged.
This is a little dipole, slingshot and a dipole, yeah. You know, it's one end.
Yeah, I think that would have been had me kicked out of the park.
I wonder why. So what did you end up using for an antenna?
I used a W4OP loop, which I had purchased about a month before, specifically for this event. And then I had used it several times on the Appalachian Trail just to get used to it. I'd also taken it to Washington, D.C. to do 4 parks there. By the time we got to the Statue of Liberty, I was pretty well versed in how to use it.
Okay, so the loop on top of no one would have seen it at all.
Put it on top of that torch, you know, just
No, we were down at the base. It sat on the sidewalk, and we really didn't get in anyone's way.
Did anybody approach you and ask what you were doing?
A couple people did, and I actually had a friend along, so I had coached her in what to say so that I didn't have to stop what I was doing because the chasers did not like that. So a lot of them just walked by and didn't ask. There were a couple that stopped and a couple that took pictures.
So you basically got to go out and be it the one of the rarest, right?
Yes, I would say probably other than the Alaskan ones that didn't get activated, this was the second activation ever.
So how are the pileups?
The pileups were wild. I started on single sideband. I prefer the CW, but I had gone with another operator I had invited along, and he was a master CW op. So the plans were for him to run CW, and I was going to run single sideband. It turned out the bands were really not in the best shape, and single sideband was not cutting it. Obviously, I was running a loop, so I was QRP. I was running about 12 and a half watts. Well, I wasn't exactly QRP, so I was 12 and a half watts. Single sideband wasn't cutting it. I worked about five or six people in the course of 10 minutes, and it just wasn't efficient. So
switched. You had a lot of factors going for you. You had female voice.
Yes.
Desirable contact.
Yes.
And, you know, all those things should be multiplying factors, and you still had a hard time.
Right,
yes,
but you're also running...
No one could hear me.
You're also running 10 watts or so into a small antenna.
Right.
But you are surrounded by salt water on an island.
Yeah. Well, so what did you do? Oh, you went back to CW?
We had a schedule set who was going to be on what bands at what time to make the best of our time. So Joe Everhart, N2CX, was on 40-meter single or 40-meter CW. I was on 20-meter single sideband, so I went down to 30-meter CW, and instantly I had huge pileups. Just changing the mode, it just really opened it up, and the CW really made it through.
So how are your CW skills?
I'm right around 15 words a minute, conversational, and for contesting, I can do about 18 words a minute, picking out call signs.
So do people blast you with the high speed, or...?
Sometimes, but as I always say, if I can't copy them, they don't get the context, so they usually will slow down.
Yeah. QRS.
QRS, yes. QRS, QRS. No QRQ there. But So how was, you said you were in D.C.?
Yes, I also went to D.C. and did the National Mall. I went through the National Park on the Year website and found the four units in the National Mall that had the least amount of QSOs. So I went to those four, and I think I worked a total of about 350 QSOs altogether. It was very cold. It was about 35 degrees out.
You're from
the contest ran all year. You could have picked a better.
Yeah.
Well, I didn't have as much time during the summer to get out, and I didn't have the loop. The loop was what allowed me to be able to get there.
Okay, so that was later in the year.
Yes.
Did the loop work for other sideband contacts, other locations?
Yes, it worked really well for the sideband as well. The only problem I found with it is it's very hard to work split on single sideband because it's such a narrow bandwidth for the loop. It's very narrow what you can work. So if you're listening on one frequency and you're transmitting on the other, one of the two frequencies is going to be slightly off. So it was hard to hear.
Yeah, so even the receive gets attenuated pretty significantly when you get out of the bandpass.
Yes.
Right. So that's a really, really sharp antenna. Did you play with any other antennas, or was it just the loop all year?
I used the loop. I also did NFED, not with a 9-to-1 Balun. I used an inverted V, and I used a dipole.
So small power, small antennas, rare contact.
Yeah, yes. Use the loop where your physical location was so restricted, you just couldn't put anything else
in
up.
In D.C. and Statue of Liberty. And I used it a few times on the Appalachian Trail just to get practice and know how to use it well before I went somewhere where...
Did you log
that's not permitted.
Did you log on paper? Or
I did log on paper.
You had to transcribe all those contacts?
I did. 350 contacts from Washington, D.C., and I typed them all into the computer.
How many did you guys do at the Liberty?
I got, I think, 103, and Joe had just, I think it was 80, just shy of 100.
How long were you there for?
We were there for about 2 hours.
Yeah.
Pretty good in two hours. I was going to say, that doesn't sound like very much, but 2 hours,
Yeah, and that 2 hours included the tear down and the setup.
Is that as long as they let you be there?
Yes, we only had a very short window. In fact, we got lucky that there was something going on at Statue of Liberty that we were put onto a ferry an hour before normal. They would have normally put us on, so we got an extra hour because of that.
So was transportation the issue, or was it just the they don't have very much space? Somebody else wanted to.
We were sent over on the employee ferry.
Okay.
So, the,
in terms of space,
no,
I've never
no,
been
I'm
there.
No, I'm talking about well, why were you limited to such a short window?
That's what they allow.
Bureaucracy.
Were they strict about it?
Yes. It was time to. She was there looking at her watch. You know, time
was,
to go.
Was somebody
down.
Else going to use your 10 square feet of space that you had?
I don't think so.
Okay, so bureaucracy.
Bureaucracy.
Probably.
Yeah.
So, what do you think you're a lot better? Do you think you're a better operator now?
From when I first started, say January, I started in HF summer, fall of 2015 to now, I would say yes, I learned a great deal during national.
Lots of pileups to manage and
yes.
Small antennas. And
yes, picking out call signs, both single sideband and CW, building antennas, learning about propagation, learning when the bands are good and when they're bad, and how to determine your best band for your time of day.
So what's next? Like, ARRL, they had the W1AW portable event.
Yeah, I'm surprised they're not doing anything this year because it was the centennial year, and then they followed up with the NPOTA.
So there's
but
this.
But they're not doing a thing this year, are
so
they?
So there's this worldwide flora and fauna thing, right?
Yes.
Is that what's happening this year?
Talk about that.
The worldwide flora and fauna is very similar to national parks on the air, but is a there's no end to it. It's all the time. I mean, it's last year, this year. It just started in the United States a couple years ago, if I'm not mistaken, and it just started getting popular because of the national parks on the air. A lot of the sites are the same. In fact, most of the national park on the air sites are also a worldwide flora and fauna.
So what's the goal of it? What does it have to do with flora and fauna other than that's an identifiable thing?
Yeah.
I think their key phrase is make nature your shack. So it's to encourage hams to get out, use portable radios, portable antennas, and just get outside. And
not just
and
on field.
Right.
Correct.
Right.
Yes.
So how many activations did you do in total?
In total, the national parks or the parks on the air?
NPOTA.
I did 53 total, and I worked 389 parks, I believe.
How good does that put? How high does that put you up in the leaderboard?
It put me in the top 100 overall. I believe I was fourth chaser in Pennsylvania and fourth or fifth activator of Pennsylvania.
So who was the? How many activations did the highest activator have?
403, and that was Stuart KB1HQS.
Yeah. Go figure. And you rendezvoused with some of the other activators, right?
I did. Yeah. We rendezvoused with Stuart, KB1HQS, also Ruth, KM4LAO, and her mother, Sharon, Peter Kobach, KOBAK, or K0BAK, Joe Everhart, N2CX, Nick Molo, KC1DKY, another
Tim,
couple.
Right?
Tim Carter, yes, W3ATB. And Carrie and Ray, who are KB3WAV and KC3RW.
And you met them all through NPOTA?
Yes. And there were a couple others.
Yeah. So besides just the on-air part, there's a lot on Facebook for this, right?
Yes, Facebook was very active, and a lot of people became friends through the Facebook. Even if you couldn't be out activating or out chasing, you were always
there's still a Facebook group,
yes.
You have a lot of fun on that?
I did, yes.
Did this activity tend to gather younger hams than our median demographic?
I think so. I think a lot of them got involved. It was something to do other than sitting inside at your shack. I think they enjoyed going out. A lot of them were already hikers. A lot of them also did summits on the air, so this was something they could do as well.
So, I mean, I think in soda in general, there's not a lot of old farts who are willing to hike up 5,000 footers carrying a radio and then get on the air.
Okay.
So
I haven't done that, but I could.
Because of the way science works, not as many old guys.
Okay.
Right, and that was the nice thing about national parks on the air. You could just drive in and you could run it mobile in your car.
Right, so you didn't have to hike in it. You know, a lot of people just did it from their car, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
And I did a few from my car as well.
Yeah.
So this sounds like what's valuable is coming up with the idea of figuring out something to do.
Yes.
I mean, it could be.
We need to be told to keep busy. We can't keep busy ourselves.
A really wide variety of things, but with the guys at the league headquarters kind of spurring things, coming up with a good idea and people jumping on board. I didn't think that Parks on the Air was going to be a jump on board thing, and boy, was I wrong.
It came out, I had talked to Sean, and he said that they were expecting it to be big, but they were not expecting it to be as big as fast.
Yeah.
It blew up, like, overnight.
Yeah, so I guess they're doing the flora and fauna is not a one-year thing, so it's not exactly the competition for that.
Right.
So they're not doing a one-year thing again this year. What, Sean, lack of imagination? Sean?
Well, I think everyone needed a break. They needed to do everything that they hadn't done in 2016, like mow the lawn and, you know, fix their houses and
repair the radios.
Do the laundry, you know, do everything
she
that they
blew,
put
she
on
blew
the
blew up her
board.
Radio.
I did. My radio died on me. I had to order a new one.
Do you know what happened?
It was a Kenwood TS-440, and it got the Kenwood dots.
And you blew up your 7300, right?
Yes. Well, that waited until the next year, and then, yes, that died on me, too.
So you what radio you used?
So what we're saying is don't do this, because you're going to burn up
your radio.
You
lose all your radios.
No. The problem with the Kenwood, it was a 40-year-old radio. It was on its last leg anyhow. And the 7300, it was just a fluke.
Infant mortality.
So you used a KX3 for most of it, right?
Yes.
Yeah. How did you feel about being QRP? Was the power ever an issue?
I didn't think so. I never had an activation where I did not have enough QSOs. And as long as you could get spotted, I found that the best thing to do is to have a friend notified ahead of time that was going to watch for you, or that you could text them, because then you didn't have to be on your phone spotting. They would do it for you. And once you were spotted, then everyone came, and then everyone just kept spotting you.
How did the pileups behave?
For the most part, pretty well. Sometimes they got a little bit wild and cranky, but I would say overall it was manageable.
No kids, no lids, no space cadets?
There were lids, yes. Sometimes they were kids. Those were the fun ones. It was fun to work kids.
Yeah. So I had a question, and
It's old man syndrome.
So, yeah.
So what do you think of this place? This is your first trip out, right?
Yes, it is. In fact, this is not only my first date in Hamvention, it's my first Hamvention ever.
Right. And what do you think of the place?
I like it. I think they picked a good place to do it.
You run into traffic issues yesterday?
Not really.
Not we today were, either?
Did you say this is your first big Hamfest?
Yeah, I have not even been to a firecracker. I haven't been to
okay,
any.
Okay, so this sets a pretty high bar.
Yeah.
You're going
to
be disappointed everywhere else.
Yes, I'm sure.
Everything is much smaller.
Yeah, or I recommend your next step be Orlando, so you're going to work your way down slowly.
Okay.
You go to your local flea market with 300 people and, you know, just tailgating.
Nothing will ever feel the same.
Yeah. What is this all about? But that's more of the backbone of ham radio.
Yeah.
You buy anything this weekend?
I did.
What'd you buy?
I bought a solar panel and controller so I can run my outside ops off solar power and keep my batteries charged.
So you have no intention of giving up this NPOTA like thing?
I guess I have no intention of giving up outside portable operations.
So how much flora and fauna have you been doing?
I haven't been doing that much, but the park, there's a state park about 3 miles from the house, Little Buffalo State Park. And I go there regularly anyhow. That's where I run. And I also just go there for fun for portable ops. Like last year, I would go out and just chase parks from there just to be outside. And that is a designator for the flora and fauna. So I go there and then I send my
But you didn't, hand out flora and fauna QSOs?
I did from there, yes.
No, when you were doing NPOTA, did you?
I would send my log in so everyone received credit for it. And there were a couple of ops that were big into the flora and fauna, and they would check, they would cross-reference the designators, and they would spot it as the flora and fauna, and so then you would get all the flora and fauna people. Which a lot of them are DX, so I was able to work a lot of DX because they wanted my designator.
So what percentage of the contacts you made during NPOTA were stateside in Canada versus DX?
I'd say outside
of North America.
That's a hard question. Maybe 5 or 8% would have been DX.
So it was really a USA event.
Yes.
Yes.
I was not trying to be impolite on my phone. There is a group that does rapid call out and get on the air from outside someplace. Mm-hmm. And I thought their name was Rapid Response. I've seen email from them a lot, but I don't know if you're familiar with anything like that.
I don't think I am.
So it sounds like something you'd like, because the guy
probably
announces we're all going to get on the air, and you can't, you got to be more than, I don't know, 5 miles, 10 miles from home, and get on the air. Typically QRP, portable of some kind. Sounds like something you'd enjoy. I just wish I knew what the real name was. More old man syndrome.
Old man syndrome. It's that time of day. I mean, are you going to come in tomorrow to the Ham Fest again?
Yes, we are.
Yeah. So it's a long trip, right?
It was about 6.5 hours.
So that's not bad. That's like
shorter than us.
Shorter than you. Shorter than me.
Yeah.
Yep.
Well, your trip was faster because you came at 500 miles an hour.
Probably took 6 hours though.
All well. Right. So I was going to ask about your the pileups that that you were getting into. Your first pileup operation would have been part of this.
Yes. Well, I did summits on the air, which was a smaller pileup. I worked probably 20, 30 people, but it was much strung out. I would get maybe 2 or 3 calling at a time versus 20 to 30 calling at a time.
Right.
Okay, so at some point, did you feel like overloaded? Did you develop techniques for handling them?
I did. It's called fake it till you make it. If you hear a bunch of people calling at the same time and you did not catch a call sign, ask for the person with the 4 call, because there will always be a 4 in there, and then that narrows it down. Or you can say, come back, the W call, and that narrows it down. So you just kind of...
That narrows it down.
Yes. So you just 60. Kind of pick a letter or a number and call that back, and that narrows you down from maybe 15 people calling to maybe 4 calling, and then you can pick out who you heard.
All the time that I've been doing ham radio, I have never heard that technique described quite that way.
Oh, I've
well, of course you have.
I've heard it in contesting, you know.
Yeah.
You hear 100 Europeans come back. Who's the Italy Zulu 2? You know.
There's bound to be at least one.
There's always at least a couple Italians calling.
Yeah, cool. So you figured out how to do that, and then you tried some split.
Uh-huh. I did try some split. I mostly did the split at Statue of Liberty, which worked pretty well on CW, but again, on the single sideband, it wasn't as efficient because it was harder to hear.
Yeah, so on CW, you could split within the bandpass of the receiver.
Right. You're only up 1 or something instead of up 5 or down 5.
It was very, on the CW split, it was very easy because, and once I called someone back, they came back because they didn't have 5 more people talking on top of me.
Right. Yeah.
So you were one of those hams that learned to operate Morse code who didn't have to.
Yes.
You like it?
I do. I really, really like Morse code, and I only learned it when I started learning it. I learned it because there was a couple hams that only did Morse code, and I wanted their parks. So I figured I'll learn the letters, and then I can send my call sign. He recognize my call sign if it comes back to me, and I can send my 599, and I'll get the park. And once I started learning it, I really enjoyed it. And then by the end of the year, I was doing very little single sideband except for the chasing. I still chase single sideband.
Meet this guy back here. You've seen his shirt?
What's that?
Show us your shirt.
Show us your shirt.
Can we see your shirt?
Without CW, yes.
That's our booth mate. I don't think any camera. Oh, camera
because
might have been
because the phasing
him.
Line is audio. The shirt is without CW.
Oh,
it's CB.
It's just CB.
Yes.
I disagree, but that's neither here nor there.
Exactly.
I really like the CW. I think it just adds a different view or technique to the.
But when you got into
hobby.
Ham radio, you didn't know. Interested in it.
No, I did not. I was not expecting to.
And if it had been a requirement, the likelihood is you never would have been a ham?
I got my technician with a 2-day class that a local club was doing, and someone had told me about doing the general. I was one of the ones that I figured I would never be able to learn CW. And they're like, oh, well, it's not, you know, you don't have to anymore. So I'm like, oh, okay. So I studied for my general and passed that. I had learned CW, I learned the letters just to look at. Back when I was 12, and I just had never done anything with it. But I had,
what led you to do that? Was it scouting or something?
I had a friend of mine that was a ham, WX1N, Rob Newell. He was a ham. We grew up together. And he and his brother would actually talk to each other in Morse code, and obviously I could understand them. So I had kind of learned it. But all I knew was like to see it, and I didn't even really know it that well. So when I relearned it, I had to pretty much relearn all of it.
All right. So you had an early introduction to ham radio through somebody that you knew.
Yes.
But what spurred you to get your license somewhat later?
I'm involved in the fire department. I started as an EMT, and a lot of fire companies share emails, share trainings, and I saw that there was a ham radio training. So I went to that, and when I was there, I heard about field day, and I thought, oh, well, that sounds kind of fun, you know, outdoors. And they said, well, and I knew that to be on the HF bands, I needed a general like class license, so I thought I would get that. And they said, well, you don't need it because you can use our call sign. But I was like, well, I'd rather have it anyhow. So I went and got my general. And then this past year, I studied and got my extra.
This is an awesome step-by-step.
Yeah.
It's classic in many ways, but it's also your own unique experience and how this came about. And I haven't run into a lot of people that decided to learn Morse code. And that's not the reason I expected you had learned it. I thought, I knew about it. I just thought, you know, another challenge. No, you had a goal.
You wanted to work those parks.
Yes. Yeah.
And I guess, you know, to some extent, the expeditions and other on-air activities that where CW has a big advantage have spurred some people. Because if you want to work the next big de-expedition, you'll have a better chance.
Anybody can work a de-expedition on CW.
Yeah.
Send your call sign. You know what your call sign sounds like.
So what's your CW capability?
My CW skills are mediocre. I probably have the XCC on CW, but I'm not a killer CW op. I don't enjoy it as much. I'm a phone junkie.
But use it if you got it.
I use it if I got it. I've worked you on CW before.
Yes, we have.
I've worked Gary on
CW. You did not work me on CW. No, I've got some interesting stories, though.
I've seen you trying to pretend to work K1N.
I tried to work K1N, but I failed even on CW.
Yeah.
And the last actual CW contact I had, I was down at the beach, and Jeff, AC4ZO, former Ham Radio Now co-host, was home, and so... We thought, we'll do a CW contact. Jeff's a CW guy. And so I was thinking, well, this is going to be an extended rag chew. There's no reason for us to plod along at my 15 words a minute when he can copy 30 words a minute and I can send 25 or 30 words a minute. I just can't copy that. So I'm sending along 25, 30 words a minute, and he's coming back to me at 15 words a minute. And when we finish, another guy calls me at 30 words a minute. No, as a guy I knew, this is not going to fly. So I'm QRS, and he's running a Vibroplex bug, and he cannot slow it down. So and it's just he's
that contact
trying,
did not happen.
He's trying to just kind of fall apart pretty quick. So yeah, I'm a no code ham, but with
you,
the K,
you were a
Kano code ham, but not a Kano it very
yeah,
well.
Yeah, Kano it, I can do it, but no Kano it.
Yeah, but. Awesome. It's a valuable skill.
I really enjoy it.
Someday in my retirement, I'll brush up on
Isn't
it.
Isn't this your retirement?
Oh, yeah, that's right. Sorry.
Well, the first CW QSO or rag chew I had was with a ham that was 92 years old, and he learned code at 70. So I think if he can learn it, anyone can learn it.
Okay.
Excuses aside. We have no good excuses.
Totally chagrined. But I know it. Yeah, and my only other excuse is I passed my code test in the FCC office in front of the man. So there you go.
No one has
the opportunity to do that anymore.
All right. Well, let's wrap things up here.
Are you done? Because I'm just warming up here.
I'm tired.
I'm liking being on your show and not my show.
What?
I'm liking being on your show and not having to be on my show. This looks very much like my show.
But it's my show. I assume you want to go home. And I want to walk around a little bit and then go home. So I am Marty, KC1CWF.
No, you do this. You reintroduce your guest.
I know. I'm getting there.
Well, you do that first and then... Okay, go ahead. Do it your way.
My show.
Yeah,
I'm Marty, KC1CWF. We're with Emily.
The chicken with fries.
KB3VVE, talking to POTA. My sidekick monkey is Gary KN4AQ.
Yeah, trained monkey.
Yeah, you can find us at PhasingLinePodcast.com. Click the donate tab as you should after you listen and figure out how awesome we are. And then go to Gary's website, hamradionad.tv.
If you've got any money left at all, after you've given most of it to Marty.
He has a pig. His pig is hungry and needs to
Arvin.
Eat.
Arvin.
Starvin' Arvin. I take full credit for that, by the way.
Did you come up with that?
I came up with that. Ah. Yeah.
Wait, well done.
And we will say 73 and talk to you soon, because we do not say...
Over.
And out. Bye-bye.
Over.
And out. Okay.
I forgot to do this on the previous two shows, but this is for camera synchronization.
It is not to get anybody's attention.
It is not.
I think our levels are receiving.
You're hot. Talk.
1, 2, 3, 4.
There you go.
I need
testing
to
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Okay. I think your mic's hot or something, because I hear.
Oh, we can turn that mic off entirely.
Yeah. Right. Are you okay? Great. You rolling?
We are rolling.
Okay, I am rolling there.